This episode of Beer with Nat is brought to you by me. Hey everyone, Nat here. I don't normally run ads on the podcast, but this season I've got my own shameless plug. I wrote a book. Available on March 19th in the UK and April 28th in the US, Beer, Taste the Evolution in 50 Styles is a taster's guide through the history of beer. To learn more and pre-order your copy, visit beerwithnat.com/book. Okay, time for the show. Welcome back to Beer with Nat. On every episode, I share a beer and a chat with people who do what they love for a living. They work in the beer industry. Today's guest is Becky Kean, co-founder and director of Nirvana Brewery, a London-based brewery that specializes in alcohol-free beer. You'll hear how Becky first discovered beer, how a road trip to Germany with her brother helped her get her start in the beer business, and what her day-to-day with Nirvana looks like now. We also talk about the no and low alcohol space and how it's grown, some of the different approaches to producing alcohol-free beer, and of course, some of the challenges. Finally, Becky tells us what she learned from her previous roles, how they've helped with the work she's doing now, and what she enjoys most about being a part of the beer industry. Here she is.
Okay, so I've bought two beers. I've bought my own beer, which is our Nirvana Brewery Hell's Lager, 0.3%. And I've bought a St. Austell Brewery Cornish IPA called Proper Job.
Very nice. So yeah. What one do you want to start with?
I guess we should start with the Cornish IPA, because
that's a bit of the history.
Exactly, that's where my beer journey started, even though really you should start with the lowest alcohol, because otherwise it might ruin your taste buds. But
that's true. We'll do it in the reverse today, yes. Understanding that yes. It's for the historical purpose.
Okay. So St. Austell Brewery was where I did my first brewery tour, and that's kind of what started to pique my interest in craft beer.
And when was that?
So that was, I think, 2013. So not that long ago, really, but
no.
I was into beer before that, but just generally kind of lagers and mainstream beers, and I didn't really get the whole craft beer thing. I hadn't really tried a proper range of craft beers with lots of hops and things.
And then how did you end up in Cornwall at St. Austell?
So my friend had a niece who needed babysitting for a week, and she pretended that we were having a free holiday, and I was like, yeah, come down, stay with my sister,
and do a
free holiday, yeah. And then, yeah, no, we were babysitting. No, but it was fun, it was good.
And what did you take away from that brewery tour? What led you to take the brewery tour? It was just something to
do. It was something to do, yeah, and actually, I found it so interesting, because I really love looking into where things come from, and learning about, you know, the food and drink that we have, and where it comes from, or anything, really. So, yeah, it was really nice to actually learn about how beer is made, and you know, obvious stuff now, to me, like the malt and the hops and things, but back then I didn't really think about it, and it was just really cool to learn about the different types of malts and different types of hops.
Yeah,
and
definitely.
The different effect you can get.
And so, was this the one that you had then, sort of at the end of the tour?
So I had a nice sort of three...
Oh, a little taster.
Yeah, a little taster platter, yeah. Three different beers, and yeah, I remember this one was one of my favourites.
Yeah, all right, cheers.
Yeah, cheers.
Thanks for bringing
That's
it
right.
in. Hmm. Oh, that is so nice. Mm. It's got a lot of bitterness.
Yeah,
yeah. Yeah, it is quite bitter for, I think, most English IPAs tend to not have that bitter hit.
Yeah.
But this one definitely does.
Nice.
It's really
yeah.
refreshing.
Yeah, really nice and hoppy and, yeah, really balanced, I think, as well.
Yeah, and it will be a nice contrast to yours, since then yours is a lager. And,
yeah, exactly.
We'll experience some different flavors.
Yeah.
All right, so we've mentioned your beer mm-hmm. a little bit, mm-hmm. but let's talk about the brewery.
Yeah.
So you are the co-founder and director of Nirvana Brewery, mm-hmm. which is based here in East London. Mm-hmm. So we'll start by talking about the business, then we'll talk a little bit more about your day-to-day.
Yeah.
So where did the idea for the brewery come from?
Yeah, so Nirvana Brewery specializes in alcohol-free beers. So we do craft beer that's 0.5% alcohol or less. And the idea came about 3 years ago, we started, because me and my brother... we're looking for a beer for our dad. He chose to give up drinking quite a few years ago, and it totally transformed his life for the better. And we're also pleased with this development and really happy for him. But we were always kind of enjoyed sharing beer together, and I was sort of getting into my craft beer a lot then, and so was my brother, and my dad was like craft beers and ales and things. And so our sort of family functions, social interactions had sort of changed a bit, because when he stopped drinking, he couldn't join in with all this sort of craft beer sharing. So we wanted to find a craft beer that we could bring to the table for him. And that's kind of where it started, was we were looking for a nice beer. When we couldn't find one, we started to go out to find someone who could help us make one. And then eventually we found a guy who was also looking to start an alcohol-free brewery called Steve Das. And when we met with him, and we were like, this, you know, there's, you know, totally something here. We've been looking for something that's really good craft beer that's alcohol free, and we can't find it, so let's make it.
It's so amazing to just think you had this idea and now here you are a few years down the line.
I know,
and you've got this great brand and all of these different products, and you know, you're one of the few breweries actually brewing their own alcohol free beer here. So what does the day-to-day life look like as co-founder and director of a brewery?
It is a bit manic at times.
I can imagine, because that's a big title. That's a lot to
do. So my brother-in-law is, he sort of does more of the operations side at the brewery. So he helps out with the brewing, and we have a full-time brewer as well. So they do more of the production side. Mm-hmm. I'm more of the business management and sales and sort of being a brand ambassador and going out there and trying to share our beers with the world. So actually a lot of the time I'm kind of traipsing the streets of London, visiting bars and restaurants and kind of talking about Nirvana.
And shouting about the brand.
Yeah.
I know you said you're not in charge of the operations, but I know you can of course speak to it. So what are some of the challenges faced to make an alcohol-free beer versus a traditional beer that would contain alcohol?
Well, obviously you're changing a huge part of beer. So obviously alcohol will carry most of the, that's where all the body comes from. It will carry a lot of the flavours. It will contrast with the bitterness of the hops and things like that. So it is this very, very fine balance between not having it too bitter, but not having it too light as well. And because we brew our beers to be low gravity, so we're not de-alkalizing. It means we're using slightly less malt, so it's there's less sugar to ferment into alcohol. And obviously that's where you can lose quite a lot of body. So we do quite a few different things to try and keep their sort of
all of those beery flavors.
Yeah, exactly. Keep the flavor in there. Keep the sort of try and bring that malt flavor, malt sugar out, but without in a way that it doesn't easily convert to alcohol. Mm. So in that way, it's sort of a lot more restricted, and the type of yeast we use as well is sort of, that helps keep the alcohol low. And then it's a case of flavoring it with really nice hops. I think where with an alcoholic beer, you can. Obviously, you want to use really nice fresh hops, but if you've got quite a bitter hops, then the alcohol is a nice sort of contrast for that, and it balances it out.
Yeah, definitely, as alcohol can be perceived as a sweetness
sometimes
when it's slightly higher.
Whereas with alcohol-free, you've got nowhere to hide.
Yeah.
So you really have to make that balance, get that balance really right.
Yeah, that's a good point. And so you said there are two approaches that most breweries are using.
Yeah.
Either you produce a traditional beer that has alcohol and then you remove it, so that's de-alcoholizing, or you brew to a lower gravity, so a lower alcohol content to begin with. So either having less sugar to start with, so then you make less alcohol, a lazy yeast, I've heard people call it, so it doesn't convert as much of that sugar into alcohol. Mm-hmm. So you take that latter approach.
Yeah.
And you're one of the few breweries to actually be brewing low alcohol here in
absolutely.
London.
So we're actually still the only brewery in the UK that is dedicated to alcohol free.
And producing it at?
And producing it at our own premises. Yeah, so there are other brewing brands who brew at other breweries. Mm-hmm. And there's another brewery who does low alcohol. Mm-hmm. But when it comes to actually alcohol-free 0.5% and under, we're the only brewery that has our own premises and brews in-house and only does alcohol-free.
Why do you think that is? Is it just you know the difficulties and it's quite challenging to do it?
I think it's quite bold to just set up your own brewery for dedicated to such a niche.
Yeah.
So I guess most other people just, you know, will use capacity at another brewery or get a contract brew so that there's less risk involved in setup costs and things. So that was quite a bold move, but I think we've always been in it for the long run. We've always wanted to build a nice family business as a sort of legacy business, and we can keep going for years to come. Mm-hmm. And just, you know, we also really want to get really good at the alcohol-free brewing, and having our own premises means that we can experiment in-house, we can try out different things. It kind of gives a bit more freedom to play around and try and innovate.
Yeah, that's a good point. That if you're just doing a contract brew, it's the one recipe, that's all they're going to make for you.
Exactly.
But here you can tinker. And and what does your kit look like in terms of size of production? Do you have something small that you can test new recipes on? Or everything you do is quite a large quantity?
We have a test kit. There are some restrictions because obviously on a larger scale, we have to filter or pasteurize, which obviously drastically changes the beer. But when it comes to alcohol-free, you kind of have to do one or the other because usually you'd have the alcohol as a little bit of a preservative.
Ah, that's a very good point.
But with alcohol-free, you're a lot more exposed to bacteria and things like that.
Yeah, I knew that was a concern with draft low alcohol beers, that if you have almost less than 3% alcohol, say, then it can, the beer can spoil much more quickly. But is that the same for bottled versions as well?
Okay. So if we didn't filter or we didn't pasteurize, then
the beer could go off.
The beer could go off, yeah, much easier, and we'd have to put much, much shorter shelf life.
Okay.
So we do have to do some sort of sterilization. So on the test kit, we can try out loads of nice new brews, but then we can't always test how they'll come out after the filtering or pasteurization.
Yeah, good point. Okay.
But it's still really
good. Gives you a rough idea.
Yeah, it's still a really good way to play around. And then we have to do it on the larger scale. And our tanks are 2,000 litre vessel fermentation tanks.
Okay.
We've got a sort of the normal setup from a craft brewery: mash tun, hot liquor tank, cold liquor tank.
Just controlling little elements of it to either make more unfermentable sugars or, support your lazy yeast, whatever it needs.
Exactly, yeah.
Is it different temperature ranges, or it's just a certain strain of yeast
that works? Yeah, different temperatures as well. There's kind of a lot of little tweaks that we do.
Yeah.
So I can't always go into, like, every single one, because that's giving away our overall recipe.
What you do that's unique.
It's a very controlled process on, like, every aspect of
and
the...
And from the outside, if you walked in, it would look like a normal brewery.
Exactly, yeah. You wouldn't know the difference. It just looks exactly the same.
Yeah. Mm. And so you have quite a range now at this point. What are some of the different beers in your range, and which one's your favourite?
So we have six core beers at the moment. We do some specials and seasonal beers as well. But our main beers are, we have a Hell's Lager, which is 0.3%. And then we have a hoppy pale ale, which is 0.5, and an IPA, which is also 0.5. And then we have some 0.0s, and that's our stout and our traditional pale ale, which is a little bit more like a bitter or a cask beer.
Oh, nice. Okay. It's bringing in the traditional drinkers.
Yeah. And also at 0.0, it's a bit sweeter because there's been no fermentation.
Okay.
So we don't even put any yeast in there.
Okay.
So we do obviously try and do things to keep the sweetness down. Otherwise you are just drinking wort. So we do things to try and balance it and, you know, contrast the sweetness, but it is a little bit sweeter, and that kind of is a natural byproduct of the fact that there's no alcohol in it.
Yeah. So that's what it means then, if it's 0.0, it hasn't had any fermentation.
Yeah.
And then if they have some percentage up to 0.5, they've been fermented slightly.
Unless it's been de-alcoholized, in which case you could get it to...
Yeah, for you specifically
for
in your range.
Specifically, yeah.
Interesting. Mm. That's quite cool that you take the two approaches as well, because then you can kind of see which one is selling better and what is the approach we should move forward
and
with.
Personally, I prefer the taste of the 0.5s, but we do the 0.0s because there are people who... find it really important.
No alcohol.
Yeah, and sometimes it's religious reasons, sometimes it's health, but a lot of the time it's just a misconception about what level of alcohol is safe.
Mm.
And that's quite sad, because I think that people are unnecessarily restricting themselves because they think 0.5% is actually alcoholic, and that, you know, even though it's a small amount, it still counts, but it's the equivalent to a trace amount that you would find in a juice or...
Yeah, that's what I've heard. It's like, orange juice, or, you know, as a fruit is fermenting, it produces some alcohol.
Yeah.
So if you've got a banana on your counter, it could have a small amount of alcohol.
Yeah, it's just a natural thing that occurs in all our food and drink, or anything with sugar in it.
Yeah.
So, yeah, it's a bit misleading to then think 0.5% is alcoholic.
Yeah, but it's nice that then you offer things for the two types of consumer.
Yeah.
And again, it's really interesting to me to think how many different types of consumer there are in this space, because no one was talking about no and low a few years ago, and now everybody's talking about it. So as that segment of the market is growing, we need different things for the different types of consumers.
Different segments within that segment.
Who identify, what's your favorite beer of the ones that you produce? You mentioned you like the ones with a little bit of alcohol.
But... yeah, so for me, I would say the lager is a real classic. So even though there's so many alcohol-free lagers out there, there aren't that many good craft lagers that are alcohol-free.
Mm.
There's a lot of the mainstream ones like Beck's Blue and Heineken and stuff like that. But if you don't really like those beers when in the alcohol version, then you're probably not going to like them really when they're alcohol-free either.
Yeah, that's a good point.
Yeah, so there's not that many craft lagers and not that many that are, you know, done really well. So I'm really proud of our lager. And even though I love like IPAs and ales and things, I still really love a good lager
when
it's done well. So I think that is probably my all-time favourite. But after that, I'd say probably the hoppy pale ale, which is just a really
that
solid
really
basis.
Nice. I got to try that one recently. Yeah. Well, I can imagine the lager is probably your favourite, as it was your first baby as So let's talk a little bit about where the lager got its start. Mm-hmm. So you actually launched your own beer brand before Nirvana came to be, which was Fit Beer, which is where the lager originated. Yeah. So let me know a little bit about that. And was it the same sort of origin story? You needed a beer for your dad that the family could enjoy together.
Yeah.
But you didn't start with your own brewery then. It was getting some help first.
So yeah, as I said, we started looking for a beer for my dad. And one of the things that me and my brother did was go around Germany. So when we were looking for alcohol-free beers, the main ones that we could find that were really quite nice were all coming from Germany.
Mm.
So that was where we first started, was we did a big road trip around Germany.
Oh, how fun.
It was so much fun.
And so when was that?
So that was 2016.
Okay.
Yeah.
So yeah, you'd been getting into beer for a few years, kind of needed a new type of beer.
Yeah.
And then Germany is like heaven for beer lovers.
I know, it was so good.
And whether you want alcohol-free beers or traditional beers.
Exactly,
everything.
So we sort of toured the country, we were trying lots of alcohol-free beers. Lots of other German beers as well. But we were looking for a brewery that could make us a really good alcohol-free beer. And we found this brewery in Bavaria. And they were like us as well. They're a family business. And we just really clicked with them. And their beers were so good. And they agreed to make us an alcohol-free beer that we could take to the UK market.
That's amazing. Mm. So it was brewed there and then packaged there as well, and then it would come to the UK.
Yeah.
So you had it under your brand as Fit Beer at the time. So you essentially started a business around this beer, which is amazing.
Yeah.
And what was the concept of Fit Beer?
Yeah, so that the thinking behind that was actually our dad's idea, so that's why we named it that. And the reason it is a bit of a cheesy name, and obviously not everyone liked the name, but for my dad, it was the way he looks at alcohol-free beer now. Is that it's a positive version of something.
Yeah, that's a good point, not taking something away.
Because giving up alcohol changed his life for the better. And whilst he loves beer, alcohol beer to him is a bad thing. And alcohol-free is a positive thing.
Yeah.
And when he looked at all the alcohol-free beers out there, it's always named like Beer Zero or, you know, Beer
something
Without.
Something
free.
Like something's missing.
Like something's missing, And his thinking was that, well, actually, for him, it's beer plus something better. It's like beer plus, you know, health and fitness and well-being.
Yeah. No hangovers.
Freedom, basically, to kind of have, you know, his life how he wants it to be. So that's why he felt that Fit Beer was a positive version of beer.
Mm-hmm.
And then coupled with that, there was loads of health benefits that we found to alcohol-free beer. So I know a lot of people now cite the isotonic properties of alcohol-free beer. It's also really low in calories. And actually, our lager is really high in vitamin B and folic acid.
Yeah,
and
right.
Like that.
So there definitely are some benefits, which when you try and promote those with a beer that contains alcohol, people are like, but what about the alcohol?
Exactly. You're not allowed to promote the health benefits of an alcoholic beer.
Yeah. So then in this side, on the flip side, you actually could.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Exactly. So that was our thinking. And also, we wanted to change people's perceptions about alcohol-free beer because people think of beer as being unhealthy, and you're not allowed to tell them otherwise because it's got alcohol in it, and you're not allowed to do that. But when it's alcohol-free, people then still think it's unhealthy because it's still beer.
Mm-hmm.
And we wanted to show people, no, look, actually, beer without alcohol is pretty healthy.
Yeah, so you can kind of take it out of that shadow almost and just say it's this delicious liquid that is still made from malt and water.
Exactly, it's still really natural and it's got lots of vitamins in it and there's not got any sugar like a lot of soft drinks.
Yeah, that's a great point. So then over time, as you then set up Nirvana with Steve, you've just gone through a rebrand for Nirvana and have now folded Fit Beer into the Nirvana family.
Yeah, exactly.
So what was the thinking behind that?
So after we set up Nirvana and we started having loads of different products, still had Fit Beer under the Fit Beer brand. But then after a while, we sort of were managing these two brands and we felt that Fit Beer wasn't such a strong brand for the craft beer market anyway. And Nirvana actually was really resonating with people.
Mm.
And also more than that, we wanted to be one family. So we're a family business and it didn't make sense to have these two.
Yeah, there's no need to have a sub-brand at that point. And I really like what you said about this idea of it's, you know, beer plus. Like, for me, then that's sort of what Nirvana is as well.
Yeah,
like,
exactly.
You're like, oh, what is that next step, that higher level?
Yeah, yeah.
Why Nirvana? Where did the name come from?
That was, like you said, it's kind of reaching this higher level. You know, it's like you're on your own. We think everyone's on their own journey. So whether you're teetotal or whether you're just maybe starting out on like trying to cut down on alcohol, maybe you don't even, you know, you're not even trying to cut down on alcohol, you just really love beer. Sometimes you have an alcohol-free beer just because it tastes good.
Mm-hmm.
Everyone's on their own journey, and we kind of want to help people live their best lives, basically. And that's kind of where the name Nirvana comes from, is that we're sort of helping people have this positive influence and positive life wherever they're at on their journey.
Yeah, and I think that's so important because sometimes with alcohol-free products, it can almost feel like people's morals are being called into question.
Yeah, exactly.
You know, and it's like, oh, we're better than. And that's not the case at all. It's we're here for you, whatever step of the journey you're on, whatever makes you feel good.
Yeah, and we're not preaching or telling people not to drink. Like,
right, we've got a beer here.
Exactly,
that's a traditional IPA. So
most of us in the brewery drink alcohol as well. And like I said, we don't judge anyone. We're not trying to tell anyone to drink alcohol free and to give up alcohol. We literally just want to be there for people if they choose to not have alcohol at any given moment.
Yeah. And how has the rebrand gone? Has it been easy to get it out to people? And,
and
what was the purpose behind it?
So the rebrand was basically to bring the Fit Beer into the Nirvana range, but also to boost the Nirvana brand, make it a bit more commercially viable, I guess, because we're this nice little niche craft beer brewery, and we'd had this organic growth for a couple of years, and then obviously we've seen loads of people coming into this category now, and so now we sort of thought, okay, well, we need to take a step back and I guess really refine our branding and make it so that we're ready to grow and become more widely available, I guess, is the idea. We tweaked the Nirvana branding. We also wanted to make it a bit more ownable to us and to tell our story about why we're doing this. So the new branding kind of takes all these elements of our story and our product. We have the hops and the wheat and the sunshine, and it kind of, the idea behind the pattern is it's like an explosion of joy.
It makes you feel good when you look
at
it.
Exactly.
There's something positive that's like radiating.
So it's just about the enjoyment of life, the enjoyment of good beer, and just basically bringing joy through beer.
Shall we open it?
Yeah, let's go for it.
Okay. So this is Becky's favorite beer in the range. And we've got a nice big glass for it since we can have loads more of this during the daytime.
Can I have as much of this as we want?
Exactly. Oh, let's cheers. Yeah,
cheers.
Sorry. I'm too excited to smell it. I got to try this earlier in the week and it's just so bready.
Yeah.
It's amazing.
So I really love this, that classic Hell's style.
Yeah.
And I know that some people prefer maybe more dry lager or, you know, something like that, but for me this is just my favorite lager style. That kind of bready biscuitiness. It's like slightly sweet, but it's not overly sweet. It's just a pleasant sweetness. Which I know a lot of people find that alcohol free beers can be too sweet, but I don't think that this is necessarily too sweet. I think it's very true to the style.
When you get into the technical description of a Helles, my favorite description of it is malty but not sweet. So it's supposed to have just enough hop bitterness to balance out the sweetness. But you still get all of this rich bready flavor. And that, like, I'm not missing the alcohol at all in that. It's so nice.
And it's a really clean taste as well. So
exactly.
A lot of alcohol-free beers can have a slightly artificial or
they taste kind of cereally.
Or it can be this weird sort of chemical flavor and mixed with an over carbonation. It can be very gassy sometimes. I don't know if you've had like Beck's Blue. It's just like, it's mostly fizz. And then
I've been avoiding that one. I have to say I've had the Heineken one and I don't mind it. But I do find that this for me is a lot more flavorful. Than something like that.
And the Hallertau hops as well give that nice nectar fruit kind of flavour.
Yeah.
A bit of honey. Kind of
all very traditional.
Yeah.
That's lovely. And so this one is still then made in Germany.
Yeah, absolutely. So the reason we do that is because this one is the only beer that is partially de-alkalized.
Ah, got it. Okay.
So we do...
Which is something that you can't do at your facility here.
Yeah.
Yet. Maybe you'll get there someday.
So we haven't so far managed to find a place in the UK that will de-alkalize... Where you can use their dealkalizing equipment. I know that Adnams have invested in some, but obviously they're using
that's
it
for their brands.
For all of their production. So, and fair enough. So, so that's why we still have to have this made in Germany where they've got loads of brewers that have that equipment. So, I think with a lager, it's important to, you get a lot of flavour from the fermentation and from that lager yeast, so you can't use the same yeast that we would use.
Yeah, that's a good point. In your, in your low alcohol brewing. Yeah.
So, for that reason, we brew part of it fully and let it ferment out and then dealkalize, and then another part of it is restrictive fermentation.
Okay.
And that way you get more of a balance, because the restrictive fermentation can be a bit sweet, the dealkalizing can leave a bit of a slightly bitter or artificial taste.
So you can blend them to the right place. Wow, it's fascinating to me to think, you know, I've done all my studies in sort of beer science.
Yeah.
And no one really has talked about this side of it. So it's quite interesting to think if maybe the studies will change in the future to include a little bit more about how to make low alcohol beers or to de-alcoholize beers. Because this space is just growing at such a pace.
When we first started, we obviously tried to do as much research as we could, and there really wasn't much out there, you know, and I think in a way, that did help because it meant that we were just then able to not take in what anyone else has done and just try things for ourselves, and really kind of innovate and lead the way in new techniques.
Yeah, that's a really good point, that it leaves you this kind of open
blank
runway.
Space. Yeah.
Just be like, okay, let's try this, let's try that, and see what approach tastes best and sells best.
Yeah, and it's difficult, obviously, because then you haven't got anyone to look up to who can follow the lead from. But I guess that's where the fun comes. So.
Yeah, and then you hope people are looking up to you as well once you've carved a path.
Yeah.
So I am so intrigued to just understand how you one day decided, you know, let's do this, let's start a business. Yeah. So how the heck did you come about just starting your own business?
Yeah.
I don't know if the easiest way is to talk about some of your experience, but I would love to hear what you were doing before this as well, because maybe that helped you get to where you are now.
So I'd love to say that I'd been in beer before and then I wanted to go off and do my own brewery, but unfortunately that wasn't the case. I actually hadn't been in beer at all.
Which is so fascinating because that's a story people want to hear.
Yeah.
You can come into this industry from not being in beer.
Yeah, exactly. And, you know, I came into it from a beer lover, but other than that, it was a big leap of faith. Before that, I went to uni and studied business management, so I know I always wanted to run a business.
Okay, so you were in the right direction.
Yeah. But I kind of thought that maybe running my own business would be like years down the line once I've, you know, had a career elsewhere.
Yeah. So what did you think you would do then when you were in school?
Well, I never really knew what I wanted to do. When I went to uni, most people were coming out trying to get jobs in banks and, you know, consultancies and stuff like that. And God, the idea of that to me just did not appeal.
Like, so you knew that didn't feel right, but you weren't sure what path you were going to be on.
Yeah, exactly. So I did sort of... I went and lived in Thailand for a while and I did teaching. Classic gap year kind of cliche, but you know, it was really, really good. And yeah, when I came back, I sort of did a graduate scheme in a telecoms company. And then I went off and did a PA work for a women's mentoring foundation. And and that was quite inspiring, I think, as well. That helped me sort of...
To be around all these other women who were kicking ass in their industries.
It's, it wasn't particularly underprivileged women. It was women in FTSE 100 companies. But, you know, it was really inspiring to see these women in these sort of top-level jobs.
Business leadership roles.
And then after that, I did a bit more travelling around South America. And when I came back from there that we started to... sort of get the idea from trying to find this beer for my dad. And that was kind of after that. I was at a bit of an open end and my brother was the same. And so we had a bit of time on our hands and just started kind of, like I said, we did this road trip around Germany.
Doing your homework.
And then it just never stopped.
That's amazing. Yeah. So if you do run into, you know, challenges, well, I suppose let's say that, what are some of the challenges that you've run into opening your own business? And then how have you found the answers?
I mean, there's... challenges all the time, so it's hard to like pick some, but there's constant challenges, a lot of challenges around, I guess, not having that experience in the beer world, when especially you're getting lots of people coming in who have experience or perhaps have the backing of a large company or a large brand. I suppose not having anyone to turn to and say, well, how is this usually done, you know, like there's so many different factors, you know, around the brewing, around the selling, around the people management, even like accountancy and stuff, you know, it's like all these...
You just got to figure it out as you go.
Yeah. And so, I guess finding the solution is really just kind of trying to find someone who can help you and trying to work it out for yourself if you can't find someone. And
So is it a lot of Googling, you know, how do I do this?
And we've been really lucky last year as well. We've got a new brewer called Steve Hunt. He came from 360 Degrees Brewing in Sussex, and he's been amazing in like adapting some of our recipes and trying new things. And so it's having really good people around is what helps a lot.
So you've gotten it started and now you can attract in the other people that will help push it forward. And so looking back on your previous jobs, were there things that you learned there that you were like, oh, this is really useful in the role you're in?
Yeah, in a way, like even though what I did before wasn't related to beer, there's definitely that problem solving that in the sort of first job I had, a lot of it was sort of just didn't know anything about telecoms. You just have to learn it so you can write it was a conference company. So I had to write like a conference agenda and things like that.
So you need to get right into the industry to be like, what does everyone else want to learn about the industry?
Exactly. So that was really good. That helped me learn how to, you know, learn something quickly and like speak to lots of different people, find out, you know, what they're saying, what they want to talk about.
Yeah.
And then, like I said, when I worked for the Mentoring Foundation, it was, yeah, got very small set up. So I was the PA for this, the woman who ran it. And so I could see everything that went on from top to bottom because there was four of us in the office maximum. So, you know, you could see every aspect of the organisation. And I think that helps then when I went to start a business, because I saw what it was like to do the invoices and the, you know, admin and the, you know, every aspect of the business.
Yeah, that is a really good point, to think being part of a small team has its benefits to see, oh, what are they doing? What are they doing? And kind of learn from everybody.
Exactly, yeah.
Did you think this is ever what you were going to do?
No, it never even came to mind. But I am really happy that it has ended up this way, because, like I said, I didn't really know what I wanted to do, so I never could have predicted anything, because I'm quite bad at knowing what I want and making decisions, and I never would have known before that this would have been a great industry to be in.
Yeah, but you found a passion and then are able to work the business around it.
And yeah, I wouldn't want to do anything else now. I mean, I love beer and I love being in the drinks industry.
So where did that love of beer come from initially?
So I never really liked beer. Obviously, you know, you don't really like when you first start drinking. And yeah, I remember at uni, I was like, right, I'm going to try and get into beer. I don't really like it, but you know, if I try a few, maybe I'll get used to the taste.
Maybe I'll find the right one.
Yeah. And I mean, I didn't really do it very well. I bought a pack of Stella and tried to get through that. And after about 1.5 cans, I was like, no, I'm not doing it.
So that wasn't the one for you. That was the next. Yeah.
And then actually it was when I went to Thailand a couple of years later, somebody handed me a Chang. And on my first night, and it was sweltering hot, and I was with a bunch of people I didn't know in this foreign country I'd never been to, and so I would have just drunk anything. But as it turned out, I kind of liked it, and you know, I was really enjoying it, and for the rest of the trip that was my main drink of choice. And that was actually when I first started really enjoying beer. And as I said, it's not craft beer, but it was, you know,
but everyone's got to start somewhere. Exactly.
And then yeah, it was after that, a couple of years later, again I went to St. Austell Brewery. And then when I was in San Diego, we went to a brewery there called Mission Brewery. And that was kind of, yeah, again, the next step into like actually really getting into craft beer.
And were you just there on holiday? And then again, stumbled upon the brewery and found these amazing beers. And what would you say is your favourite style? Is it still lager, more broadly?
Yeah, I guess I would say probably if I had to pick one, it would be lager. But I do like the variation of craft beer. So I really love stouts. And I really love really hoppy IPAs and stuff like that. So, and sours too. But yeah, I wouldn't necessarily, I like the variety. That's what I love about craft beer.
Yeah, I feel the same way. Yeah. I go into places and, you know, I'm looking at the bar or the beer board and they're like, what's your favorite style? And I'm like, I don't have one. Like, if it's well made, I'll drink anything. Yeah. I just want to try all these different flavors.
Yeah, exactly. A little bit of everything.
And you do have a sort of sour beer in your portfolio, is that right? Which is the kombucha blend?
Yeah, that was one of our sort of seasonal specials. We did a kombucha beer, and that was kombucha blended with our pale ale. And it came out like a sour.
That's so interesting.
Yeah. So if you don't know kombucha, then it might taste a bit strange because kombucha has quite a vinegary taste smell. But I really love kombucha, and I think, especially when you know about the health benefits, it starts to make sense. But yeah, I think actually as a beer, it really worked because you get that fermentation flavour from the kombucha that you often wouldn't get in an alcohol-free beer.
Yeah. And what do you see coming next for sort of the low and no alcohol space? Does it bother you if people talk about the brewery as like, oh, a low alcohol or a no alcohol brewery? Do you want to just be known as a brewery, or do you think we'll get there someday?
Yeah, I mean, we're proud to be low and no alcohol, so
it's your unique point. Yeah.
So yeah, I'm happy to be known as the no and low alcohol brewery.
Plus, it's very difficult to do what you guys are doing.
Yeah,
so
people
to then come and find out what you do differently. That's probably, it's important that they know what you're doing.
And I think nowadays it's different when we first started. When we first started, it was a lot more. There was a lot more skepticism, a lot more sort of, oh, what's the point in that? And we still do get that a little bit at festivals and things, but within the space of about a year or two, it's just totally flipped on its head. And now people are going, oh, wow, that's really cool. You know, that's really interesting. And, you know, only a couple of years ago, people were just sort of, you know, walking away going, oh, no, what's the point in that? I'd rather have an alcoholic beer, thanks. So
that's so interesting. Yeah. And what do you think has driven that change?
I think it's a lot of investment into the market from beer companies, beer brands like Heineken and other small brands like us as well, like coming in. I think people started to then pay attention because they're like, oh, everybody seems to be bringing these products in. And obviously at first there was a small following of people who were really dedicated to alcohol-free and were like really trying all these alcohol-free beers. And now it's gone a lot more mainstream, I guess, in the same way that craft beer maybe has done in the past few years.
Yeah,
so
that's a good point. A similar trajectory of still being this niche thing. Yeah. And now kind of is becoming more.
Yeah, now it's more widely accepted that, you know, sort of your average guy in the pub on Friday night might have a hoppy IPA instead of a lager. So.
Yeah. And do you have any of your products on draft yet? Or are they all still mostly bottled?
We've done our pale ale on draft.
Oh, wow. So that's really exciting. Nice. Yeah. And where does that reach? Is it still mostly London distribution at the moment?
Yeah, mostly. Mostly local to us in our East London area.
Yeah.
There have been some places outside of London that have taken it. So
yeah, that's exciting. Baby steps.
I think a lot of places took it as a dry January special.
Okay.
So yeah, that was really cool. It would be nice to see more places having a bit more of a permanent line.
Yes. Do you think that that is going to be what we see, that it will kind of have a trend in January and then fall off for the rest of the year? Or will we get to a point where we'll see this year round?
I think, yeah, eventually I think we will see it year round. Maybe not the places that only have like one or two taps, but
yeah, exactly,
where you've got a tap room with 10 or 15 taps, I think most places will start to dedicate at least one line to alcohol-free.
Yeah, if you're doing festivals, that sort of thing.
Yeah.
Is it mostly beer festivals, or do you go to places where people wouldn't think to expect a beer?
Yeah, actually, what's worked best for us is these sort of foodie family festivals.
Mm.
So where you do get craft food and drink, but it's not just about beer. So when we've been to beer festivals, sometimes they get a bit boozy, and that's when you get people going, oh, alcohol-free, what's the point in that? And yeah,
they're wanting like bang for their buck.
Yeah, exactly. Like yeah. So,
but if you've got families together and the parents don't want to drink but still want to enjoy the flavours, that's interesting.
Last year we did the big festival in the Cotswolds.
Mm-hmm.
That was really good because, again, lots of families, but lots of really good food and drink. And yeah, that's where you get maybe a group of people where some people are drinking, some people aren't, and they want the people not drinking want a good option just to like the people who are drinking can get.
Yeah, it's interesting to me because then it brings more people into beer.
Yeah.
And like you said, it's about the flavors and giving them an option and not necessarily saying, now that you're in, we only want you to drink alcohol-free.
Yeah, yeah.
But to get them used to the flavors of hops and, you know, these really lovely bready malty flavors.
Yeah.
Once they discover them, who knows, it could be someone who didn't think they liked beer.
Actually,
that might then come
we
into
do
the
get
category.
That. Yeah. Yeah, we get a lot of people who come, and it's a lot of, not to be sort of stereotyping, but it's a lot of women who try our beers and go, oh, actually, I don't really drink beer, but that's really nice. And I really like that because, obviously, as women, I like other women to get into beer because I think it's, you know, a really nice thing to have.
Yeah, definitely. And have you felt any challenges as a woman in beer, you know, running your own business now in the space?
I don't really want to say I've felt many challenges to being a woman in beer because I don't think I have. I think I'm sure, like, other women in beer have had challenges. But for me, personally, I've got a really good team around me and people, I think nowadays the attitudes are changing as well, so, you know, people don't seem to sort of, you know, think much of it, so.
Yeah, right, you're doing what you love and things are going well, so. All right, so I'll ask you my last question then, which is, what do you enjoy most about being part of the beer industry?
Can I say the beer?
Yeah. Many people do.
Especially for me because I can drink it all. I mean, I'm sure other breweries people will drink the beer all day, but you know,
I think we'll be in the same state.
Exactly.
Yours all day.
I could drink that beer all day and still work and still drive home and, you know, just crack open a beer at lunch and not have to think about it.
What a luxury.
Yeah. And then likewise, you go to industry events and that's when I get a night off. I get to have some alcoholic beers and I really love it. I just love the beer. So
awesome. Yeah. Well, thanks for giving us this new version of beer as well. Yeah. I'm really enjoying it.
Thank you for having me.
Yeah, thanks. Thanks again, Becky. Not only for teaching us all more about no and low alcohol beer, but for brewing some brilliant ones yourself. Next week, our final episode of season 3, you'll hear from a few familiar voices, but you're just going to have to tune in to find out who. Chat soon.